Hello, my name is Jessica Metcalfe. I'm Turtle Mountain Chippewa from North Dakota, and I'm the owner of Beyond Buckskin, which is a business and website dedicated to promoting and selling Native American-made fashion. And I work with over 40 Native artists to get their work out to a broader international audience. When I was talking with Kathleen about this panel, the idea was that we were going to leave on a little bit of a high note in case you guys were feeling a little downtrodden by all of the appropriation. But I'm sad to say that I think that my presentation is going to take a turn. But we'll get to that. I'll take you on a little roller coaster ride. So I often get the question whenever I present, because I talk about Native designers, but also issues of appropriation. I get the question of, okay, so, you know, what's an example of good appropriation, or what's a positive example of, you know, doing it right, right? How do non-Native designers appropriate Native cultures in a right way or a good way? And I really like the definitions that were already brought up that, and I kind of add on an extra word to that, which is appropriation is the unauthorized taking of somebody else's cultural stuff. So what's a good example of, you know, the unauthorized taking? I don't think that there's a good example of stealing. So my response has always been collaborations, but I'm thinking of changing this standpoint, and you'll see why. So I think that this is my, yeah. So I'm going to give you guys two examples. The first is Sikki M, and then the second is Valentino. So the first here, this is in 2011. New York fashion designer Sikki M collaborated with acclaimed Navajo weaver Tanaba Natani to spotlight her weavings with his garments. Natani is a fifth generation weaver. She lives on the Navajo reservation where she raises the sheep that supplies most of the wool needed for her weavings. She shears, spins, and dyes the wool, then weaves it into beautiful rugs and textiles, many of which are inspired by traditional second and third phase chief style men's and women's shoulder blankets. He paired these wearing blankets with his collection of menswear that was inspired by the work of Pueblo potter Maria Martinez. If you're familiar with her work, she was known for her black on black pottery and for experimenting with texture and asymmetrical silhouettes for her pots, and hopefully you can see that direct inspiration in his work. He explained, quote, "The beautiful thing about her work was that it was very much about the silhouette of the ceramics. She didn't use much color, so shape and texture was central to her work. She created these almost perfect round shapes and charcoal engravings. This season, I didn't want it to be conceptual and instead focus on creating beautiful silhouettes," end quote. Now, I love the fact that Sikki M partnered with a notable Native contemporary artist, and he gives her credit. It's not much, but it is rare for this to occur. In addition, he clearly states in all the press and promotional materials that his inspiration for the collection derives from the revolutionary pottery designs of Maria Martinez. Whereas many non-Native designers use a generic sense of Indianness that pulls from stereotypes, Sikki M was specific and honest and upfront about his inspiration points, and he named them. He took the time to learn about Navajo weaving and Pueblo pottery and to connect with actual people and to share that experience with his circles. And this is a very powerful thing to do. Our next example, which was briefly mentioned earlier, was with Valentino. They looked to Canadian Métis artist Christy Belcourt for their 2016 resort collection, and it was beautiful. The designers at Valentino became aware of Belcourt's paintings, which are pointillist paintings based on Métis beading traditions and floral patterns. And these floral designs align perfectly with the designer's penchant for vibrant floral patterns in their work. This brand used a range of fabrics for this collection, some solid, some sheer, with her dazzling bead-like florals printed or embroidered across full-length dresses, jackets, skirts, and even a halter top. About this collection, or in collaboration, Belcourt said she researched the brand and asked questions first. She explained, quote, I needed to know if they had ever been accused of cultural appropriation, if they had ever had models walk down the runway in feathers or headdresses. I needed to find out what their environmental track record was. Water Song, which is the painting that they transferred to textiles for this collection, is all about the sacredness of water, she said, and our responsibility to the water and the earth. She would go on to explain, quote, it would go against everything I believe in to be involved with a company that was abusive to the environment and to the human beings from whom they source the materials. I don't think that Canadians are quite aware that there's a really big movement of resurgence and reclamation happening in Native communities all across the country. It's beautiful to witness and be a part of, to see people practice the ceremonies and put the pieces back together again, end quote. Now, she would go on to talk specifically about this collaboration, saying the designers, whether they're small or major fashion houses, need to stop appropriating the cultures of Indigenous peoples worldwide. They need to begin to work with Indigenous artists and designers to have respectful representation in ways that the Indigenous artists and designers feel is appropriate. It is not up to non-Indigenous people to decide what is appropriate and what isn't. End quote. Belcourt said she hopes future designers will follow the lead of those at Valentino, both in preserving the environment and cultural appreciation. Now, I would love to show you guys this video, which is an interview with Christy talking about this collaboration.
Bonjour. My name is Christy Belcourt, and the title of the piece that I used was Water Song. It began with an email that I got in my inbox, which said, we are writing you from Milan, Italy, which I thought was spam and promptly deleted. And then they had to contact me on Facebook and say, this is not spam, please read this. And then we just took it from there. We had a telephone conversation, and it went from there. We started with some conversations about appropriation. We spoke about whether they had ever had models walk down the runway with headdresses on. We also spoke about the environment and what their environmental stance was. They have been voted number one by Greenpeace for their environmental stance. They have a commitment to reduce all toxins out of their production line by 2017. So those two things were really important for me. So they agreed, and I agreed, and then we just took it from there. Water. The main inspiration for Water Song is water. It's an ode to fresh water. It's about the sacredness of water, the beauty of water, the spirits that are in water. And of course, there's incredible stresses on the waters around the world. And we know that without fresh water, we won't survive, and neither will any other species. So water is probably the most important issue that us as human beings are facing right now, but yet we're the ones that are responsible for it. And so we need to think about that in everything that we do. I thought it was totally cool. I mean, they did a stunning job. Valentino's work generally is always beautiful, clean lines, and I think the blend between my artwork and their artwork went really well.
Sounds great, right? So that essentially was going to be my presentation, but then my friend and colleague, Adrian Keene, shows up into New York City and shows me a picture of this. And so she was out shopping with her sister at TJ Maxx and came across this shoebox. It is a shoebox for Valentino. And then she wrote a blog post on it that Valentino had learned nothing. The central question was this shoebox made prior to the collaboration with Christy or after the collaboration with Christy? And through this, we also were shown this This is a backpack, Valentino backpack, and you can see the beadwork on the sides of the backpack are direct ripoffs of traditional moccasins. This was researched by Jamie Akuma, who did the beaded boots for the main program of this show. Okay, so Jamie Akuma is a native beadwork artist, Shoshone Bannock, and her mom found these original moccasin designs. The top is Kiowa, and the bottom right is Cheyenne. Both are from the late 1800s. So we went on this mission yesterday to find this stuff, and we found it on the runway. And so there it is, there he's wearing it, and then you can see that same star design, which is ripped off from the Cheyenne moccasins, also shows up in the camo jacket arm. And so, again, we were like, was this before the collaboration or after the collaboration? It was at the same time. It's in the same collection. You can see Christie's textiles alongside of these ripped off pieces. See, Belcourt mentioned specifically that she asked if they had ever been accused of cultural appropriation. Have they ever done this before? Well, they hadn't been accused of cultural appropriation because they were in the process of appropriating. Now, this is really, really significant. So these are beaded designs that are held in museum collections or private collections, and they're available online to find. And I mean, Adrian and I were sitting here in the audience during Susan Scafidi's presentation, which was fantastic, but we were searching for the sources of these beaded designs. Now, this is significant because some tribal leaders and members are feeling a need to go into lockdown mode. We are making a proactive decision to not share any aspects of their cultures with outsiders. When I was at the School for Advanced Research in Santa Fe in 2008 and 2009, one Pueblo tribe requested that certain items, which went beyond the sacred items, to be kept in the archives, not on view, essentially hidden to outsiders, but accessible to only tribal members. So it didn't matter if you were native or not, only tribal members would have access to these. To them, to these leaders, there was no need for outsiders to study or learn about our designs because it would ultimately, inevitably, be taken, replicated, commodified, and therefore taken forever from their hands, their control, their ownership. And these Valentino knockoffs were part of the same collection as I had mentioned before. This is problematic because of many reasons, including the first. One fashion reviewer wrote, quote, "Before anyone screams cultural appropriation, the house has approached the inspiration with taste, even collaborating with Métis artist Christy Belcourt for its resort collection," end quote. But she was not consulted for the rip-off pieces. Her role was specifically for the painting to fabric collaboration. Other retailers, such as Barney's New York, also misunderstood and misrepresented the collaboration, stating, "made in collaboration with artist Christy Belcourt of the Métis tribe," which again is not true. She did not collaborate with this piece. This is another rip-off piece. The third point is that it legitimized the collection as a whole and added value to the other beaded pieces. The fourth is the economics, which has already been brought up multiple times. I work with Native artists, amazing, talented, creative artists, most of whom go relatively unrecognized and do not garner the international recognition that a brand like Valentino does. And these artists and our Native communities and reservations feel the economic impact of others selling our stuff for their benefit and monetary gain. The sneakers sell for around $3,000, and there's at least 4 different styles. The beaded purse goes for at least $6,000, and there's at least 3 different styles. The backpack is a couple grand, and I don't know how many styles they have of those. Again, we just found this out yesterday. These companies are making a lot of money off of selling a culture that is not theirs to sell. The last is that not only were ripoffs present, but also stereotypes. And here, I wasn't even looking at the shirt. I was looking at the beadwork. And I zoomed in on the beadwork and came to the shirt. Here's a shirt featuring caricatured Indians in headdresses running with rifles. We don't run with rifles. Riding horses and shooting bows and arrows. And I could go on. So, where do we draw the line? Do we even draw a line? What is okay? What is not okay? These collaborations exist, but they are rare. And when they do exist, they aren't necessarily always a good thing. The bad cases of cultural appropriation by fashion brands far outnumber the good cases of good collaborations. There are a couple ways that companies can ethically participate in the tribal trend, I think, and prevent the kinds of situations that misrepresent Native people, perpetuate stereotypes, and reinforce systems of racism and popular culture. I was like, oh, just wait, I'll throw the R word in there. The first is to be proactive in properly engaging Native American people and tribes. And this is where, if you want to take notes, you can take notes. Be proactive. Companies could do this by directly reaching out to Native communities through their official representatives or to individual artists. Consider collaborating with a Native American artist or group. The second is to research the cultural significance of the items you wish to represent. Items of religious importance, such as headdresses, require greater respect. And this goes back to Susan Scafidi's three S's, which are also very important. The third is to understand that most, if not all, Indigenous communities have experienced histories of harmful exploitation. This is where we're coming from. We're constantly being exploited. Ask the source community if they wish to share this aspect of their culture and how they want it shared. The last is to avoid literal knockoffs. We live in a beautiful world where we can be inspired by the cultural practices of other people and share our own cultures with others. Inspiration, however, implies creativity and requires some degree of originality. Avoid profiting off of a literal knockoff or a recycled stereotype of Native American cultures. I like to leave people with action items. It just makes me feel a little bit better about stuff. The first would be to learn and share. Education is key. We're not getting it in K through 12. I don't think we really get it in college unless we actively seek it out. But education is key to tolerance and understanding, and respect is missing from current cultural appropriation actions. And my friend and colleague, Adrian Keane, says, quote, there is no respect in taking designs or cultural markers from a community, divorcing them from their meaning and context, and selling them for monetary gain. The next would be to support the movement by financially backing it and buy Native made stuff. It exists, it's out there. I know, I work with these artists, I run a website where we sell this stuff, we ship it worldwide. The last is to encourage collaborations. What an amazing source that we have right here at the National Museum of the American Indian, where they have contacts with artists throughout the United States and Canada. Just if you're walking down the street and you see something that raises a red flag, like a headdress, don't be afraid to walk into that store and ask. Are you working with a Native American artist? Does any of the sales from these items go back to the source community, or are you continuing processes of extraction? I know that's a lot to ask, but you know, and then end with a smile. Just wondering. And then encourage them to seek out actual Native American artists. I used to believe that by working together, we can learn more about each other and advance cross-cultural understanding and appreciation, which then leads to greater respect and honor. After the Valentino thing, I'm really starting to question that. But just one concluding thought. Please go to the source. We can start taking an active stance to support Native designers, especially in our own day-to-day wardrobes, and help rekindle the ancient legacy of Native American adornment and reverse the assimilation assault of the past. It is now the easiest than it has ever been in the past 100 years to buy or acquire clothing, jewelry, and accessories made by Native American fashion designers. You're going to hear from Virgil Ortiz and Doug Miles, who are both great, here in a second. Many of these designers are connected to their communities and are keenly aware of what sacred symbols and items should not be for sale to outsiders. Instead, they look within themselves and draw inspiration from their own personal backgrounds and experiences. They know how to translate the artistic traditions of their communities to create items that can be appreciated and enjoyed by anyone and everyone. Furthermore, in staying away from stereotypes, they present a new vision and a new version of the native in fashion. Let's give our Indigenous designers the opportunity to show us the potential of native fashion. Thank you.